you guys for showing up, because this is not going to happen without you. So that's a little bit about me and what's going on. I'm going to now turn it over to RP, who led the season.
I'm Rich Votto, founder and CEO of Stage 32. Some of you guys might know me as RP. I think a couple of you might. Just wanted to thank Carrie for having us and for helping us put this together. At Stage 32, you know, we're all about diversity. We're all about shining a light, not on the norm in Hollywood. You know, we want to kind of break the mold. I'm also an activist, screenwriter, and producer, so somebody who's been involved with the film, one called Another Happy Day, that had a female lead, a female protagonist that played up at Sundance. I've written a few scripts that have had female leads, and I've, you know, had to fight that battle, hearing that nobody wants to see this. We'll talk a little bit about that. So this is very important to me and very important to everybody that's up here. These are all, everybody up here has worked with Stage 32 at one point or another, or will. And, you know, we're just very, very proud of this, and to be associated with the Producers Guild and associated with Carrie, who works her ass off, and Amanda, who helped put this together as well. It's just a huge thrill for me, so I thank everybody for coming out. And I didn't think we'd start the day with men being applauded, but it's kind of a cool way to start, so I'll leave it there.
So women's impact, I'm gonna give you a little bit about them. Women, anybody who's here in the PGA who is not a part of WIN, this is what we're about. Women's Impact Network mission is to promote gender equality as a part of the PGA's larger vision of diversity by examining and addressing barriers facing women in the entertainment industry. And of course, events like this are gonna help. And we are planning many more like this, and my goal is to make this an annual event. If you have any questions, or if you'd like to join, email womensimpactwest@producersguild.org. So, that's all that. This is the important stuff that we're gonna talk about right now, and I'm so thrilled to have every single person sitting on this panel. First, we've already got RB from Stage 32, we've just met. Joey from Stage 32, right here. We've got, I'm just gonna go down the list here, Jennifer Breslow is the VP of Scripted Series at Lifetime. We have Stephanie Wilcox, the VP of Development at Rumble Films. Mara Tasker, the Associate Producer for Vice Media. And Tiffany Boyle, the VP of Packaging and Sales for Rama Law. So I'm gonna start with, if you all can just give a little intro about yourselves and what you do, I'd appreciate it.
Okay, cool. Hi, my name's Joey. I recognize a lot of names today, it's amazing. So I'm the president of Stage 32 Happy Writers. I am part of Stage 32. I handle a lot of the screenwriting for Stage 32. I've heard thousands upon thousands of pitches. I actually used to work with Stephanie at Bold Films years ago. I'm just so happy to be here today. I mean, especially seeing the shift of the pitches that we're getting recently, I think it's really a great time for this, and I'm excited for it, so thanks.
Hi, I'm Stephanie Wilcox. I'm the VP of Development and Production for Rumble Films, and before that I was at Bold Films. I was a co-producer on Whiplash and an associate producer on Nightcrawler. I worked on Drive and a couple of TV series and things like that. So that's me.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Breslow. I'm Vice President of Scripted Series at Lifetime. I've been a network executive for 10 years. I've been with Lifetime for 4 years since June, before that 2 years with ABC, and before that 4 years with CW, the beginning of creating that network. And I spent 6 years making my way through the trenches before that. So I'm a buyer and developer of television shows.
Hi, I'm Mara Tasker. I'm the development executive with Vice Films and Learning Partnership with Big Fox. I'm also an associate producer for our short form content. I produce a lot of segments of the field for Vice.com and broadly.
Hi, my name is Tiffany Boyle. I work at Rama Law. We are an entertainment law firm that represents producers, financiers, and a handful of writers. And I'm the non-attorney there who works with our clients in helping them develop, package, and find distribution for their films. My background's in development and finding worldwide distribution before I came to the firm, so that's my main thing.
Great. To start off, can each of you talk about, in general, what you see in the marketplace and how it's evolved over the last decade or so?
Yeah.
about 50 to 60 movies a year. So we have, and we do everything from $25,000 movies up to about $40 million. So we see all the different ways that a movie can get made. And so I don't know that I have specific patterns that I think have changed, because there's the tried and true way, and you find that angel investor and you make it. And then there's the really ways that people get creative of linking in tax incentives, making sure they have the right actors, bringing in a sales agent to approve the actors, pre-selling it. So I think that there's no wrong way to bring in the financing, as long as you have all of your legal in place. I don't have to say, because I work for
That's amazing. I will say, kind of on the new media side, as it sort of also pertains to film, I think one of the things that we've seen lately, I was talking backstage, if you will, about this, is that the internet has always been kind of a wild west for content. What we're starting to see now is different aggregate sites and different platforms, different media brands actually having creative power, and consumers knowing which brands to turn to for which kinds of content. And we, as artists and producers, I think are still in the process of figuring out how to properly utilize that brand power to help elevate whatever content we're working on.
From the network side, it's been it's changed drastically from over the last 10 years, even in the last 5 years, and even year. There used to be 4 to 5 major buyers. Now there's 54. So that's the biggest change I've seen over the last 5 years. I'm competing with Netflix, I'm competing with Hulu, I'm competing with Amazon. Those platforms didn't exist 5 years ago. Now they do, and now they're my biggest competitors. So I think the biggest change for me as a development executive is that I don't get to sit back and have everything come my way now. We have to be proactive, and we have to be our own generators of development. So so we have to be aggressive in every way, shape, and form. And even over the last year, the biggest change I've seen is that, this is a little frightening, I know you guys will not love to hear this, but I've seen scripts being written on spec more and more, and behind those scripts are 5 other backup scripts. So I'm getting pitched and sent not just a concept or not just a pitch anymore, but a ton of material to back it up, so people are really looking for series orders. That seems to be the biggest change and trend over the last year to 5 years.
I guess I should clarify that I work mostly on the independent side of film, so making films that are financed independently outside of the studio system, or the major studios at least. It's very close to what Tiffany was describing in terms of having some sort of investor or a couple of investors put money into the movie, but you're also pre-selling your movie to foreign territories to offset your risk. So in the hopes of making the movie you want to make and not necessarily having a big U.S. distributor on board up front, you put together a package of a script and a filmmaker and a piece of cast or a couple pieces of cast, and you bring it to buyers in France and the UK and Canada and wherever else and say, here's the movie, do you want to kind of be an early partner in the film? And I would say one of the things that I've noticed on being on sort of the producer and sort of the seller side in the last few years is that there was a chunk of time where if you had sort of a certain list of actors, you had like Bruce Willis and it was a $20 million movie and you have a script, it's like, okay, just go and make it, and you're gonna be fine. And I think in the last few years, we've seen sort of a shift that people are caring more and more about quality, the quality of the script, the quality of the filmmaker, really believing that it will be a good film rather than just saying, okay, well, we've checked all the boxes, we have Bruce Willis with Angelina Jolie, and it's an action movie, and so here we go. And so I think that it represents an important shift and kind of piggybacking off of what she was describing about all of Netflix and Amazon and Hulu and all these people getting into the game. There are a lot of specialty distributors who have gotten into the mix, like A24, who just released Ex Machina, which is very well. And I think that's sort of changing up the game a little bit too, in the sense that there are a lot more places to take your movie if it is a good movie, and there are a lot of more people who will support it and try to give it the right release pattern. So from my perspective, at least the last couple of years, it's a very good time to be a director, a producer, a seller, as we say. And another good indication of that is the Sundance Film Festival that just happened, where there were a bunch of massive sales of Meet Earl and Dying Girl, a movie called Dope, also sold for a lot of money. And so I think that's another indication that, you know, and those are both movies without big stars, new directors, et cetera. So that's another indication that I think, you know, quality of the material and the ultimate quality of the product is becoming more and more important, because people can find out really quickly if a movie is terrible and choose to not see it. So that's the biggest shift I would say I'm seeing.
Cool. Well, like I said before, I hear thousands of pitches regularly. And when I started the Happy Writers 4 years ago, I would always ask executives, what are you looking for? What are you looking for? And at that time, I never really got the answer, female-driven content. Lately, I'm getting that more and more, which is fantastic. And on the script side, too, nothing frustrates me more when it's male-oriented and it's all about the guys. Oh, and the female, she's sexy, athletic, and gorgeous, and smart. Like, it's just that the smarts at the end. So so it's interesting to see the shift and just screenwriters becoming more and more educated about how the marketplace is shifting and how females should be seen in such more of a positive light than just a physicality. And I want to say with Mara, she directed a film that I saw last year, and the female protagonist was such a kick-ass, powerful, smart woman, and stuff like that that inspires me. And it's interesting to see the female executives and the male executives really getting more and more tired of the stereotypes of female characters in films. So, yeah, that's it.
Speaking of what Mara said, and also Stephanie, there, you know, the proliferation of online distribution channels and then the specialty distributors and the people that are coming in and buying films. You mentioned A24, I think they did the most violent year too, right? Yeah, I mean, you know, doing films that probably wouldn't have gotten made or even theatrical a while ago. But what's interesting now, so when I talk to filmmakers, producers, screenwriters, they're not so worried about distribution anymore, at least theatrical, because there are so many places to go now, and it's all about putting out quality content. I think with, you know, the, you know, all these streaming services, for example, who are now moving into original content, even though the barrier of entry to get into making a film is lower than ever, we just had a film that went to Sundance that was shot on iPhone 5 called Tangerine, and I think it just got theatrical, right? Yeah, so I mean, that just happened. So the barrier of entry is lower than ever, but the need for quality content, I think, is higher than ever, because the competition is so severe now that you don't want to be buying or getting involved or getting in bed with people that aren't producing quality content. You have to, you know, there's only so much time that people have to consume content. I think we'll reach a tipping point at some point, but we're not there yet. But until we get there, you know, it's all about quality content. So a lot of stuff that probably wasn't going to get produced years ago, or where people were going after traditional financing methods to try to get something done and were being challenged by the fact that the film is too small or it's a female-centric character or whatever, these people are taking matters into their own hands and going and crowdfunding. And that's something we didn't discuss either, but that's a big sea change that's happened. So people are finding a way to get their movies done. Mara did it with her short, right? You did it crowdfunding-wise, right? So I think that you can, I think it's a different mindset now, that it's not just about, man, we gotta go out and do the dog and pony show and try to raise the money. It's let's make the film under any circumstances possible. Like, let's go raise the money, let's go find a way to do it, let's go shoot it on our phone, let's go edit it on our phone, let's do what we have to do and get it out there. And I think that's been one of the biggest changes that I've seen.
So I'm gonna throw in a couple facts here. The National Association of Theater Owners President John stated that 2015 is the year of the woman. According to Box Office Mojo, this is worldwide numbers. Hunger Games, three movies under its belt, $2.3 billion. 50 Shades, one movie. I don't care if you like her or not. It still made $570 million. Cinderella, $475 million. Divergent has two films, $559 million. That's worldwide. We've got TV, we've got Madam Secretary, I have to mention, on CBS, CSI Cyber, ABC, How to Get Away with Murder, Agent Carter, Selfie, NBC, American Odyssey, State of Affairs. I wanna change this conversation now to female-centric storylines and what we're seeing. I don't have any information on the media, I'm sorry, so I'm gonna start with you on this question. With all of that in mind, what is the marketplace right now for female-centric stories?
Great. As it pertains to new media and in general, I think one of the things that we're seeing right now is that women, for example, in the Sundance Labs, we know in Hollywood that the numbers are quite skewed and that women are producing an incredibly small amount of the content being created, but at the independent space, it's much closer to 50-50. And so what the result of that is that we're having more female voices kind of penetrate the independent market, and then the trick from there is making sure that those same filmmakers that get picked up to do studio films, that number is still favorably male skewing. So the challenge now is to figure out how to elevate women outside of the indie realm. In terms of new media, it's a bit different because women can take advantage of the exact same tools that men can take advantage of. And what's happening now is a lot of women are creating different YouTube channels that are going public and getting picked up and getting even different orgs from different companies to kind of turn them into scripted series ideas. We have the same access to Vimeo platforms and the same access to things like Stage 32, which can help us kind of start to balance out, continue to further balance out what the independent space can do for women. And the more that our voice is present there, the more pressure we can put on sort of the mainstream Hollywood system, if you want to term it that. And one thing that I can say, sort of from working at Vice, is that we have a company that reaches 40 million people a month around the world. And everyone actually thinks that our content is male skewing, but we're pretty much 50-50 now as well. And so to that effect, we are creating more women's content. And what that means is that we are hiring female filmmakers, hiring female producers, and we're creating content that is about women in the world. That's both news content, scripted content. And so really what we're seeing now is that these different online platforms that have served as even news media companies are now turning to original content. And even those companies are embracing what women can contribute to that pool. So I think really it's a matter of, for the ladies, I think it's a matter of figuring out what the tools are that we want to kind of really get our hands around and what each media brand sort of promises for us.
I'm happy to speak to this as someone who works a lifetime. First of all, I'll just say, as a card-carrying feminist, I'm so happy to work for a female-driven network. It's really a joy to be, really just part of an organization that's for women, by women, and all of the content is female focused. I mean, that is our brand. It has always been our brand, and now more than ever, this is no longer sort of a niche audience. It is becoming much more mainstream. I think in the past, perhaps it also had sort of a derogatory connotation to it. A women's network wasn't as populist as it is now, and that's incredibly inspiring. The one thing I will say is we still aren't there yet. I mean, even in the industry, Mara spoke to it a little bit. The industry standard for female writers was 11% last year. At Lifetime, it was 43% for our movies last year. That's a big difference between the industry standard and what we're doing, and I'm really, really proud of that. The other thing we're doing is that, and we still feel like we challenge ourselves to do better even than that. We want to be the leaders and we want to set a good example for everybody. So one of the things that we instituted this year was something called Broad Focus, which is an initiative to raise awareness, to make the barriers for entry much smaller for women as artists, directors, producers, executive producers. So we are creating an initiative to give women a pipeline to get their content made, a pipeline to get focused, and one of the first ways that we're doing that is partnering with the Bentonville Film Festival, and we are an exclusive partner with them, and that is May 9th. And one of the best things that comes out of that partnership is that we have promised to license and distribute a film from that festival on Lifetime. So they'll have automatic distribution, and we've also guaranteed that a script from the festival will go into our development pipeline as well. So really proud of all the things we're doing.
That's fantastic, wow. That just leads to our next question of the barrier of entry. We've got Vimeo, we've got YouTube, online distribution. Let's talk about the importance of these things and how you guys are finding your materials these days. Anyone?
Well, I'm a little bit more limited in terms of
the ways that we find our materials. We're still, as a network executive, I still am beholden to submissions through agents. Legally, I'm not allowed to read anything that isn't from an agent or a lawyer. That said, you know, we find ways. One of our best success stories is of the last 2 years is that we were presented an AFI short film written and created and directed by a woman named Sarah Gertrude Shapiro. And that short film called Sequin Rays came out of the AFI Women's Directing Workshop. We optioned that film. We then paired Sarah with Marty Noxon as her co-showrunner, and they wrote a pilot script for us. And then that pilot script was developed into a series, and that series will now live on Lifetime June 1st. It's a very unusual story. It came out of a short film, so that's one of the best things that most untraditional things that we've done in the last 2 years. But it's certainly the more traditional routes are still what we're beholden to, unfortunately. But that said, Blacklist now, we have now are members of the Blacklist website, so I'm able to read scripts and. If anything sparks my eye, that is now available to me, whereas, 2 years ago, it was just a list that came out through the agency. So now there's access to the scripts as a Blacklist member. So there are evolving ways, even in the traditional format.
Tiffany?
Yeah, I would say, things like DJ are good. And I've actually made a lot of, I've only been involved with DJ for 3 or 4 months, but I've actually made at least good connections with people that I've met off of it. And they've always been really great and easy to work with. But one of the other ones that I use all the time, and it's a little hard to get onto, you have to go to like ASM or CAN or something to be able to get onto it. I love Tenango. They'll show every market that people go to, and they're often production companies, sales agents who finance and produce, distributors who also sometimes finance and produce. And I do all of my research on Tenango. Almost all.
I would also add,
Nando, C as in cat, I, N as in Nancy, A, N as in Nancy, D as in dog, O.com.
I would just add on sort of the digital media side that we actually, because of the company model that we have, we are not actually referring to only accepting submissions from managers and agents. We're open to take unsolicited submissions, as it were. Which is obviously a bit of a headache for our in-house legal counsel, but we're always willing to review things because what we're kind of looking for on this side of things is stories that are really originating kind of from the grid of the real world. And that's something also to know that is important to know, again, when approaching a company, when approaching a brand, is knowing what they're looking for and how you can touch into the type of topics that they want to be covering. So we'll take submissions from different field reporters who get in touch with us, we'll take submissions from people who live in Detroit and who witnessed different riots. We'll take submissions from anybody, because what we want is stories sort of from the ground that we can then spin into narratives with them, so.
I use the Blacklist as well, and there's another website called Spec Scout. I think it's just specscout.com. And it's a similar sort of platform where you can upload your scripts and have them posted, and then there are readers and they do coverage and write them, and so as an executive, I can go on and sort by things that I'm looking for or grades that scripts have gotten. It's a really valuable resource, which is similar to what the Blacklist does. And I work at a company of 3 people, so having a sense of what's out there and what it's about and what the genre is and what people thought about is very, very helpful in terms of getting through material. And then also, another thing I would point out is that there's been a big trend in people filming not just short films, but also doing sort of specifically proof of concept trailers, or a short film that's sort of a chunk of a movie that they'd like to direct. That's been getting a lot of attention lately. There was a teaser for something called Leviathan, and that was ultimately picked up by, I think, Fox and one of the producers of X-Men. And that was a teaser for a massive, massive sort of studio movie, and I think it was about 3 minutes long, and it was put on Vimeo and went viral. And then there was another one that was called Sundays, and that was, I think that went to Warner Brothers in a bidding war, and it was made for like $50,000. And it went viral, and people started talking about it, and it ultimately sold to a studio in a bidding war. And so I think that's a good example of
things that you can do to say, okay, well, I know I have this feature I want to get made, but I'm an unknown talent, or, you know, the marketplace doesn't feel ready for the story yet, or whatever the barrier is, and say, okay, well, how can I do a 2-minute chunk, a 3-minute chunk for a lot less money and really show what I can do and show what my vision is? And I guess that's a good time to mention that Whiplash, the feature, was ultimately made after there was a short film proof of concept of, you know, 15 pages of the script, and that was turned into a short for $20,000. And then when I was at Bold, we saw the short and the script and said, okay, well, you know, we'll take a chance on it. We felt much better doing that, having seen what the director could do in a short. And so I think that there's a lot of ways to, you know, with a lot less investment than what you might need for a full feature, to get together with some friends and a little bit of money and crowdfund and say, okay, well, I'm just going to do this chunk and show people what I can do. And a lot of things are being found that way.
I think that's something that's really changed dramatically over the last few years too, is that, you know, stuff you mentioned, Sundays, and the guy that was that led the charge on that was a guy named Jairo Alvarado, who works at Circle of Confusion. And when I spoke with him and asked him, you know, what's changed, like what over the last couple of years, would you have done this 2 years ago? Would you have been able to find these people online? And he said the biggest change is curated content. It's the fact that there's sites out there that I can go to where there's peer reviews that I can go and look and see what's popular and what's hitting. And that's very, very different now. And that's another reason why a lot of people are, you know, just going out and shooting as opposed to waiting and trying to raise money and the proof of concept that Stephanie speaks about. And we see it on Stage 32 all the time as well. We have producers and directors that come in and find writers, you know, directors that come in and find actors, because these are people in the community that are high rated, so they're able to go in and see their reels, their resumes, things of that nature. It makes it much, much easier to find not only content, but talent. And that's something that's really dramatically changed over the last few years. And just look at the trades, and just look at people, you know, every day, well, not every day, but maybe once a week, you'll see people, you know, CAA signing 5 YouTube stars, or this person's getting hired off of, you know, a video they made on Vimeo, or they sold, you know, it was the Vimeo short of the week or whatever. It happens all the time. And that's been a dramatic sea change as well over the last couple of years.
One thing I just wanted to add, and I think Ruby said it before, is that there's so many venues out there for producers and writers to showcase their work. If I was a writer, I would be so confused and overwhelmed, because you just Google how to get my work out there, and it just the ways are endless. So it's really, in my opinion, it's being so proactive. One of my favorite shows is Broad City, and it's just so fantastic to see these two girls, women, starting out making their own content, to getting Amy Poehler involved, to becoming one of the funniest shows, in my opinion, on Comedy Central. And also, just to embarrass somebody like Keitha, who I'm obsessed with, and just seeing her just work her butt off to write her own material, direct her own material, and to make such amazing content. She didn't wait around for people to come to her. She made content, and they went to her. So to me, that is just something that everybody, any artist, should really take to heart. Because there's so many ways out there to get your work out there, but content is king, as always. So yeah.
Well, going with that, are there any new online avenues and resources that producers and writers should be aware of? And we all know YouTube, but is there a secret little gem that you can tell us today?
Well, Mara and I were talking about Seed and Spark. It's a great new crowdfunding platform. And I think one of the things that really sets them apart is that it's partly crowdfunding, and obviously getting money for your projects, but it's also selective crowdfunding. There's an application project to get your stuff up there, so everything on there is very, it's all quality material. You have to sort of prove that you have a team in place, you have an idea, and they sort of walk you through that. And then also it's really about building your audience. And I think that's, you know, people talk about crowdfunding all the time, and I think one of the things that's sort of overlooked is that it's not just about getting money up front, but, you know, getting your audience in early. So showing them that, okay, here's my idea, here's what I want to do. And just when you have that sort of kernel of an idea, you're building your community of people who are going to support it when it's ultimately finished and getting it out there. So that's just one that I would mention.
Excuse me, what is it called?
Seed and Spark. S-E-E-D and S-P-A-R-K. I think it's just seedandspark.com.
Just to add on to the Seed and Spark comment, Seed and Spark is also working on different distribution deals, so they can sort of basically get these short films that are being finished on their site into different television sets around the country. And they're putting together incredibly robust distribution deals at that. So it's really, it's an incredible example of kind of what the tech industry is meeting the film industry and how they're figuring out how to kind of elevate the content that, that they're helping curate.
And I'll whore Joey out. The stage stories of happy writers, the reason that I brought the happy writers into the fold was as a writer myself, I found that there were so many snake oil salesmen out there and so many garbage sites and, you know, educational opportunities for people who, you know, were calling themselves a screenwriting consultant, and then you kind of looked them up on LinkedIn and they were an insurance agent in Nebraska and got fired a week ago and decided that they were now a screenwriting consultant because they really, really, really liked the script of Pulp Fiction. So when I came across Joey and I saw what he was doing and he was working directly with executives who would accomplish things in the business, here they are, example A through D, it was amazing to me. And the hands-on approach that he takes and the way he works with the writers was fascinating to me, and that's why I wanted to bring the company under the Stage 32 umbrella. And it remains that way to this day. You know, there's 300 executives that either listen to pitches or teach for us, and every single one of them accomplished something gigantic in the business, and you're getting access that you would never get before. And I think that that's invaluable, because now you're getting access, you're getting feedback, which, you know, a lot of times you put your work out there on some of these sites and it falls into the void. You never hear anything, you know, you just get a pass, let's say. So it's very different, and I'm very proud of it, and I'm very proud of him. And so I just have to throw that in there as well.
Well, I'll share the love really quickly. Just with Stage 32, before it even became live, I knew about it, and I've been emailing Amanda for, like, you guys up yet? It's just so exciting to see such a collaborative group of artists. And the fact that it's grown to over 400,000 artists from around the world, and it's all word of mouth. And it's just because everybody truly cares about each other. They really care about people succeeding. And we get the executives because the writers are proactive and they do take education very seriously. So, I love you too, man.
Another thing I want to add is a company, sort of a new company that I discovered through a women's group that I'm a part of. But it's called Scripted. It's the word script and then just d.com. And Scripted is basically an open resource for writers where anyone, you don't have to have management, can upload their scripts, and the team at Scripted will figure out kind of what the content of your script is, what the genre of it is, and sort of distill it. And then from that, they'll update the executives there. I met with the head of Scripted a couple of weeks ago, and she is incredibly aware of all the projects that they have on their site and what all the writers are interested in doing. And through our meeting, I'm now meeting two of the writers that she sent to me from Scripted who don't have management.
I think we've kind of covered this, but I want to throw it back out there. How important is it to adapt an online presence? I do a lot of indie features. So, like with Whiplash, did he put his short out there and get his credit first? Or how important is it, even though I'm doing feature films, that I get that presence online before I go to one of you guys?
Well, with Whiplash, it as a short, it went to the Sundance Film Festival, so that's where most people saw it. But I mean, I'll just start by answering the rest of the question, which I would say it's pretty important. But I think when you say sort of an online presence, I think that can be a very intimidating sort of thing. Like, what exactly does that mean? Like, you have to be the wittiest person on Twitter, and you know, and what exactly do you have to do? And I mean,
follower numbers, does that matter?
I don't think it's a quantifiable thing in that way. I think to me, I mean, speaking from sort of me personally and my side of the business and what I do it, I think it's really more just an extension of being a presence in your community. And so we know that, like, in person, you know, and helping your friends and seeing them and going to mixers and getting out in the world and not just, you know, sitting in your closet and never going to see anyone. And I think now social media is just an extension of that, right? So it's, you know, how you keep in touch with people. And I think when that comes to, you know, being an artist and figuring out what your project means and then ultimately making projects, you know, you don't want to be the person who just all of a sudden shows up on Facebook one day never having had an account and is like, hey, does anyone have a lot of money that I can use? Or, you know, and I think it's just important to be an active presence in your community and support other people, support other artists,
that you know support, I mean, whether it's friends or family or whatever they're doing, so that then when you need help from other people, you have sort of a community to call on. So to me, it's much more that, and then of course it helps to be able to get your content out there and have it be seen, but I don't think that necessarily starts with just a number on your YouTube channel or your Twitter page. I think it's just about, you know, having a voice and representing yourself, and I think that's one of the ways that we can do that.
I would say I'm in line with Stephanie. You know, for me, a lot of it is maybe your social media standpoint. I just need to be able to check and make sure you are who you say you are. That's a big part of it for me. Because if we've connected and we've had a conversation and I felt like there was potentially a way to look together, I just want to be able to know that you, in fact, have done what you said you have done.
I think that, you know, it's interesting that the world has gotten a lot smaller and that, you know, we're doing, you know, people are editing films in, we have people on the site, for example, that, you know, an editor in the UK that's editing a film for somebody in LA, because you could do that, or somebody in Sweden who's scoring a film for a guy in New York, because you could do that these days, because you can transfer files. The world is getting smaller, social media has been a big part of that. I think it's a very, very important tool. I think you really do need to have a presence. I think it presents an enormous opportunity to create a contact list or a support group or whatever you're looking for in a manner that you couldn't do walking out your front door. So I think that it is very important to have an online presence. I definitely think it's quality over quantity, but I think you really do need to put in the time. I always say, for me personally on the creative side, I say social media, I say that networking is 50% of my job, and writing and doing all the other stuff that I want to do on the creative side is the other 50%. Because if you're not getting out there and you're not making those contacts and you're not finding champions, and I think you guys would speak to this in a lot of ways. I mean, a lot of the material that comes to you, most of it isn't unsolicited. You know, it's people you work with or people that are championing that you trust that bring it to you. Well, how do you get those champions? How do you make those contacts? How do you get somebody that says, you know, wow, this is really good, I need to pass it on, you know, to somebody that I think can help you? That's where social media comes in, and that's where I think it's really, really important. But I also think you need to work smart. You know, I was never on Facebook. It held no charms for me, you know, at all. I don't need people to know what I'm eating for lunch. And, you know, if you want to send me baby pictures, you can text me or email me or whatever. So I didn't want to be on Facebook. I went on LinkedIn as a creative, and I used to go into the LinkedIn groups and, you know, post questions and everything like that. And as I like to say, when it comes to creatives, it's good for, you know, it's good for blue collar, white collar, you know, that kind of thing. But, you know, I would post questions and nobody would respond. So I used to say that LinkedIn is a place where conversations go to die. You know, so, you know, as a CEO of this company, I kind of have to break myself up here. As a CEO of a company, you know, I'll go on to LinkedIn and I'll, you know, there's certain contacts that I've made there that are fine on the business end, but as creative, it's never done anything for me. And that's one of the reasons why I started Stage 32, is that a niche social network where all creatives can come together, and that's the only people you're communicating with, that's all you're thinking about, that's all that's being discussed. But if you're gonna be on, I'm also on Twitter, and I love Twitter, because it's a way to, you know, it's a great way to network, it's a great way to reach people that are otherwise unreachable. And if you handle yourself right there, and you cultivate relationships, and you're not handling your social media selfishly, and you're being selfless, you'd be amazed who will respond to you if you reach out. So, you know, it's an art form in a lot of ways, but it's a very valuable art form to, you know, be able to learn how to use it well to make you, you know, make your connections, but I think it's invaluable.
We're gonna go to something that Jennifer already kind of touched on. How do you accept materials? I know that sometimes it's agent only or has to come from a lawyer. So for each of you, if you could speak to how you accept materials and if you could give a little etiquette to submissions as well.
I guess I'll start. Because we are a law firm, I'm probably different than the rest of the panelists, but you know, our firm was started by a woman who became a lawyer at 23 years old, and she kind of hustled and worked her way up, and now there's 12 people at the firm, mostly women, two men. So we are very much about trying to help people get to where they are trying to go. So I'll take an initial phone call with anyone, but beyond that, that really depends on what the material is, maybe who you were referred through, and I work on either like an hourly or percentage basis. So again, it varies just depending on where you're at.
We do, I mean, we of course, as I mentioned, we don't have to necessarily take, we can accept unsolicited submissions, advice, but the other thing obviously is that personal referrals are the best. Of course, I always check in with managers and lawyers and reps who I know and who I trust, but we'll, of course, read anything. But in terms of etiquette, I would just say it's always a good idea to keep in mind kind of the volume that people are receiving, and I know my favorite thing is incredibly short emails. Script attached. Promise I'll read it.
I second that. A short log line is really all we need when you're submitting your script, and then the script will speak for itself. The one thing that the sort of piece of advice that I would give is that you know, at least for the more traditional outlets like Lifetime and all the other cable networks, most of the executives are busy, and most of the time we don't have the hours in the day to read unsolicited material, but our assistants do. So if you guys really want to be proactive, treat our assistants like they're future executives that they are. They are reading on our behalf. Go and incite a relationship with them, because they have my ear and they are reading and screening for us just the same as we are. So that they are a wonderful, underutilized way to get your material read and seen.
We don't accept unsolicited. It's the same sort of agent, manager, lawyer policy for both legal reasons and bandwidth, because we just don't have enough people to do that. 3 people, 1 assistant. So I wish I could, but I think all of the resources that we've mentioned thus far, aside from getting things through managers and agents, et cetera, like I said, they do go on the blacklist and spec scout and things like that, because it really does help curate material. And so I think that's a great way to get your work seen, because, and obviously with happy writers and stage 32, it also kind of, it just helps executives sort of sift through the piles and go, okay, this is really something that interests me from the genre, the story, et cetera. And that's why, I mean, I rely on people like Joey to help sort of direct me to the things that will actually be right for the company. And I would definitely back up the etiquette of treating assistants like they are people. And I think that also goes for just, you know, in general, when you're networking, whether you're reaching out to people and cold calling or sending emails, et cetera, to just remember that we're all people, and to, you know, it can still be sort of personal and intimate. It doesn't have to be sort of just a purely sort of business, sort of aggressive pitching thing. At the end of the day, you know, when we do work with writers and directors, it's usually many years of working together, and so it's your first opportunity to show what kind of person you are. And if you don't represent yourself well on that first go around, it's very hard to change that perception. So I think that's, you know, it's very important to just be respectful, but I think also going sort of beyond that common sense of represent who you are and who you are as an artist, even with that first initial call or whatever it is.
I totally agree with that. I mean, I started Happy Writers 3 years ago, actually this one 4 years ago, because I used to work at both films. I would answer the phone calls and writers and producers trying to send us the work and weren't able to. So I created this forum, Happy Writers, to allow writers to get to executives, like these ladies over here. And to second what Stephanie said, is that when I do these pitch sessions, I notice that the writers that see the most success with us go in not as salespeople, but as people. Because these executives, they want to work with people. They don't want to work with robots. They want to work with people that they can go out to drinks with, to have a good time with, you know, spend 3 to 4 years with. So I think, and we'll talk about this more in our private consultations, is that when you go into these meetings, go into it like you're talking to a friend and not that anybody's higher than anybody else. So I totally agree with what Stephanie said.
I'm gonna actually ask a question. I know the answer to it, but I want to be cool to hear you guys, because this is a question that comes up a lot. What is, you know, you say, put the log line in, get to the point, get out. But a lot of people want to put in their accomplishments and what they've done. And, you know, sometimes it's like one Joe screenplay contest, and that's probably not going to sway you.
What's that? That's a good one,
Joe's screenplay. Joe's. what is of value to put in a query letter or to put in to communication with you guys, any correspondence with you guys, and what isn't? You know, what sways you and what might, you know, what kind of makes you go the other way? Because you can go the other way. Like if they're putting something in there that's kind of insignificant, it may turn you off the other way.
I think that's right. For me, it's more about legitimacy. You know, have you participated in a film festival? You don't have to have had a script in development at one of the networks, but you know, where has your work been? And can I look at your submission and see that you've legitimized yourself in terms of how you've written your script? You know, where you learned how to write. You know, those sorts of things. It's just about feeling like you didn't just, you know, start yesterday, and that it's going to be you know, the hour that I'm going to spend on the weekend reading your script is going to be a value for you and for me.
What helps me is when there's a realistic factor. When I get submissions that are, I'm going to write, direct, produce, star this $10 million movie, I immediately go, oh no. So I think that, you know, there's an understanding of what you've done, where that fits in the marketplace, what you're looking to do next that is a realistic next step. That's what will help, I think, in my case, make sure that I can potentially actually.
I think the main takeaway is treat the assistants like people. Sounds like common sense, but apparently not.
It's not. And by the way, it's actually some of the best I've heard today. You know, I have so many friends that have risen from the assistant ranks, and they all do, and they're actually good at what they do, so it is very important.
Let's go the other route now. What things should people not do when trying to get their work seen? Do you have any lovely horror stories you can tell us? Learn from other people's mistakes.
Well, I would say, you know, I'll kind of like sift through a few of them. You know, honestly, in terms of horror stories, it's just about people not treating executives or vice versa as people. And thinking that it's so much more to it than it is. And I think it comes down to, one thing that bothers me and some of the executives, not all of them, is that when executives give feedback, and there's such a fine line between being constructive with your defense and then being argumentative. Again, in terms of these pitch sessions anyway, these executives, they're lovely, amazing people. This one thing that always stands out, and they remember, I mean, when we go to networking events, I hear executives talking about our writers and how amazing they are, but you can never go into a pitch session or any meeting, obviously, being argumentative or going into it almost with like a chip on your shoulder. So always go into any meeting with executives because they will remember for years, and we have to talk about instances, years, Y-A-R-S. So, yeah.
One of my first things would be able to accept a no and continue the relationship because there might be something later. And then my other thing would be, please do not call 18 times a day. I am actually in the process of terminating. I'm actually in the process of terminating a client who's a legitimate client who has really good content. I just had to say, I can't do this anymore because if he couldn't get a hold of me within 3 hours, I would get 4 calls of him yelling at my assistant. I would get 3 emails about how I'm not there for him. And I think, again, there's that being realistic factor of there are other things we have to do in a day. In order to get my job done for you, I have to make calls for you. And if I can't make calls for you just because I need to talk to you, that won't work.
That's a good one. I would add 2 more things. It's great to do research and to be really informed about business and to kind of understand the marketplace. But I would say don't cross the line unless you have like a physical production background. It's good to, you know, don't pitch your script and say, okay, well, it's going to be $100 million and it has to be shot in this location. And I mean, like, that's our job, you know, just focus on the story, you know, focus on the characters, focus on, you know, if you're a writer, if you are a producer and you do physical production, great, you know, but do the things that are in your power, you know, as a writer, as a director, or if you are a producer and you have a plan, but don't kind of go outside of it. I think there's a tendency because the sort of DIY spirit of the industry where we can do short films and all these things on YouTube and Vimeo, et cetera, to then kind of go to the next step and say, okay, well, I have all this stuff laid out. And if I look at that and I say, okay, well, this is a $5 million movie, not a $100 million movie. Like, it just starts on sort of the wrong foot. So don't, you know, kind of speak to things that you don't know about and don't really need to know about, to be honest. And then the other thing I would add, and I see this quite a lot when I'm hearing pitch fest and people, you know, cold calling and sending log lines and stuff, is to don't change sort of your voice as an artist to fit what an executive wants. Seek out the executives who are making the material that you want to make. Because I, you know, when we do pitch fest and things like that, or when we put out what we're looking for and we say, you know, if I say I'm looking for thriller, psychological thriller, or, you know, sci-fi, etc., and then someone comes in and they have a comedy and they're pitching and they go, well, there's this really dark moment where this guy falls down the stairs, you know, and it's like, it's just kind of, it's a waste of your time and you shouldn't change your voice to suit what I'm looking for because there are other people who are making exactly what you want to make. So focus your time, I think Arby said, work smart, you know, I find the people, do the research, go on IMDb Pro or Studio System or, you know, just Google places and look at their filmography and research what the executives are doing and find the people who are making what you want to make rather than trying to change who you are to suit their needs.
That was the best advice probably all morning. It's doing your research, and it give you such a statistical advantage to be able to, not only from the standpoint that you're not wasting your time or wasting the executive's time, but you're also letting the executive know that you have looked into what they're doing. And if you can personalize it in any way without being creepy, don't say like, yeah, I looked at your Twitter account and I noticed that you like Italian food. Am I seeing my script has a scene in an Italian restaurant? It's contained further in an Italian restaurant. You know, don't do that. But the one other thing I would say is, sort of 1A to that, is here's a horror story I heard just this past week, was a screenwriter went out and decided that he was going to carpet bomb a bunch of the executives via email. So he didn't do his research, obviously. He was putting out a sci-fi, high-budget sci-fi thing, and he put it out to about 100 different people, and he didn't BCC it. He CC'd it. So, I was at an event, and all these executives were having a great laugh about it, and they were like, oh yeah, and the name just kept coming up all night, this guy's name. The next time this guy goes to submit or gets in front of somebody, they're gonna remember that. They're gonna remember that. Not only because obviously he was lazy, but, you know, didn't think it through, but, you know, it's you're putting everybody else's email out there. I mean, it's a horror story in a million different ways, so be smart, be careful, make it personal without being creepy, and you know, you'll have a distinct advantage, I think, over a lot of people.
One more thing I want to add, that I think is pretty important, which you mentioned, is being able to still carry on and continue your relationship after you've been turned down. It's incredibly key to be able to do that, and especially, unfortunately, women are still getting a lot of no's. Most women screenwriters still get a lot of no's on projects. So it's really key to turn that rejection into research and to figure out as soon as they say no, okay, then what are you looking for? What was lacking in the script? And to try and pull notes from those kinds of conversations. Because the odds are we get pitched tons of projects, and I'm sure everyone here has read hundreds of thousands of scripts, and we're constantly reading during the weekends, and so we're not obviously making all that content, even if we like it. So the other thing to figure out is, again, just all the reasons that we turned it down, was it not a brand fit, was it something in the character, and try and turn that into some information that you can then utilize, and then continue to be cordial and continue that relationship.
The only other thing I'd add, just from a pitch perspective, is that we as executives don't expect you to be off book when you come in, and there's also, on the other side of that, don't come in and read, you know, don't come in and give us your pages and look down and you know, and have sort of a more disconnected experience. You're pitching your story. Pitch the broad strokes from your heart. You should be able to pitch it off the top of your head because you know it. And if you know it, then the nerves don't get in your way. So for me, it's just about being confident in your work and being personable without being creepy. And you know, it's okay to be nervous. We recognize that it's going into rooms and meeting people is a nerve-wracking experience. We're human too, so we get it. And just relax into it and own your own voice and own your own pitch and own concepts. And focus on the big picture. You know, we don't need all the details, just broad focus. What are the broad stories?
Now we're gonna go to the other side of the spectrum. Somebody has interest in your sprint. How do you keep that dialogue going? I'm gonna talk about a little bit about how I've had interest from 7 different people, and then all of a sudden, and all communications just stops for no apparent reason. The infamous Hollywood no is how I like to describe it. Can you talk about a little bit more how to keep the interest, or, you know, again, we don't want to be fired by Tiffany. You know, how do we keep this dialogue going if someone has stated that they are actually interested?
My mantra is bi-weekly follow-up. It's far enough away, but not too.
Bi-weekly follow-ups. Yeah, I would also add to that is, I mean, obviously when our writers get requests, we always follow up and we always do our due diligence. Sometimes an executive will suddenly be thrown on a movie and 3 months they're in India and there's no way to get a hold of them. So I don't like to fly, I'm not flying to India to get an answer. So it's just about being patient. Just one quick story I'll add is that I had a writer pitch to an executive, and they actually had a really good relationship, and they kept in touch, and the executive took time to read it, went to Jerusalem, etc. One day the writer called him up and said, you know, did you read it yet? And he said, my father just passed away, I can't do this right now, like in tears. The writer, out of the goodness of his heart, sent the producer flowers, apologizing, and made a vow that, okay, I'm just gonna let him, you know, get to me when he can. A day after the flowers came, the producer said, I got the flowers, I appreciate it, I read your script, and now he's producing his project. It's a true story. So, but it wasn't done creepily, because he didn't follow up after the flowers. Did you get them? Did you know that? I'm a good person, though. So, I'm just going to talk about it to you.
I think it's also a matter of figuring out, like you were touching on earlier, is just what are the realistic next steps? If someone expresses interest, I think the next question then is, okay, so now what do you need to see? What do you need on my end? And then figuring out also what you need on their end. And I think coming up with even just a timeline the next couple of weeks and the kind of communication that you guys want to have and the next conversation that you want to have. It's really important once you have them on the hook and figure out that there is sort of a mutual interest there in working together, just to figure out what's the next conversation to be and when are we going to have it and kind of continue that.
I think the way that you phrase that is also very key. I think saying, what can I do to help, is goes so much further than, hey, where are you, why haven't you read this, or what's going on with you, or, you know, and I think that's something that I do as a producer, too, and there are a lot of times where I'm trying to get in contact with someone that we're working with on a project, and the same thing happens to us all the time, so it's not like it's you know, restricted to just people trying to get into the business. It's movie making and making TV shows and all these things. It's a very long process, and people are very busy, and we all get sucked into multiple projects. And I think saying, you know, when you do your bi-weekly follow-up, saying, you know, is there something that I can do? Is there something that you need from me? And trying to have it be sort of a, you know, an offer of help as opposed to a, you know, I'm pestering you and I'm getting impatient, that kind of thing.
From on the series side, you know, we read pilot scripts most of the time. And so for me, the next question is always, if I'm interested in a script, the most proactive thing that you can do is say, let me tell you about the series. So you have to think like an executive when you're selling your own script. Where's the, you know, at least in TV, longevity is key.
I have one more thing also to your story of getting 7 people who are interested in the radio silence. I think that happens quite a lot where people might say, I really like the writing, there's a lot here, it's compelling, but it just doesn't get over that next hump, and it might take a little while for you to find that out, which I know is very frustrating. But there are a lot of things going around these days that tell writers, or tell executives, who the great writers are in the business, even if their scripts haven't sold. So we mentioned the blacklist, which is an online platform now, but stems from a list of the best unproduced screenplays in the business. And there are a bunch more lists like that. There is a female-focused list, it's called the Bitch List. That's the same thing, didn't make that up. There's one called the Hit List. There's the Young and Hungry List.
These are all things that are compiled annually of great scripts, most of which haven't actually been optioned or set up at a studio. Some of them have. But those, all of those writers are probably people who at one point had seven people who were interested and said, I really like this, I really like it, but then it just didn't get over that next hump. And that doesn't mean that it's the end of the road, and executives and producers remember those scripts, and they talk about them, and when they talk with their friends and say, hey, have you read anything good lately? You might say, I passed on this, but I thought it was something special, and you might want to take a look. So it's going back to the idea that a no is not necessarily the end of the road. That can still mean something very positive for you, even if it does turn into silence and you don't get optioned or set up or whatever it is you're looking to do. It can still be a very positive thing, so don't get discouraged.
And take a general. If anyone ever says, let's take a general, take the general. I had a general with a writer 7 years ago, and 7 years later, I hired her to be a co-EP on the series that I'm working on now. Just from that general meeting, we finally found a way to work together. The general is never a waste of time. So get in rooms, get face to face, make a personal connection.
What was the general?
General meeting. Just go in, talk to the person, hi, how are you? If it's offered, yeah. If it's offered to you, if it's given, take it up. No, it's that, those are never a waste of time. Yeah.
Now to go to the question why we're all here, the pitch. Can you tell us what you're looking for in a pitch? You know, we know good story, we know confidence. Is there anything else that you specifically are looking for in a pitch, and what not to do in a pitch session? And just for the audience, just to let you know, right after this, we're going to go into questions. So if you want to start lining up, you can.
Okay. I could talk for hours about this, but I won't. Honestly, I can't stress this enough, and anybody who's doing consultations with me today, I'm going to say this to every single person. It's about you. It really is. It's about you, your personality, how you go into a room. I've had writers pitch to executives, and they're so excited, and they're so personal, and they're so lovely. And after the pitch session, the executive's like, you know what? I don't think I understood the concept completely, but the writer was so, or producer was so engaging that they requested the script, or they want to continue a conversation with them. So, I mean, if you go in and you're nervous, that's fine. Again, they're looking for people, they're not looking for robots. And that's my biggest note that I'll give to everybody today over and over again.
Any unique stories of pitches? Came in a SpongeBob outfit, you know, anything like that?
I was just gonna give advice on a pitch. I mean, the thing that makes a pitch entertaining for us is, and it's really not quite fair to writers, I would say, is that you're expected to be entertaining and to be, you know, and to sell. You are literally expected to act your show out in some ways when you're pitching, and it's not fair, and we know it, and we're sorry. But that said, you know, be entertaining. The most specific thing I can say about pitches is that know your characters inside and out. Really take the time to develop those characters. Unique characters are key for pitches for us, and unique concepts. Those are the two things that sell. How it's structured, we of course want to know how the pilot story is structured, but frankly, that's part of the development process. So if it's a little bit loose, that's okay. Ideally, it's all worked out in terms of your pilot structure, but the concept and the characters are so key. Don't shortchange the world, the characters, and how they interact with one another.
Yeah, I think to piggyback on that point, and this has been mentioned a couple of times in this panel so far, but really just the passion you bring to it comes through in spades, and it tells us if you've asked yourself the questions about what laws are you adhering to in this world that you're creating, what are your characters going to go through, what are their arcs going to be. And be it a feature or a series, if you can kind of tell us in the meeting very clearly that you've thought through the entire life of this person and the backstory and the sort of nuances in their histories that motivate them to do things, we'll assume you an expert on that world. And what that does to sort of push your pitch forward and to have it really stand out in our minds is immeasurable, in my opinion.
I would add one other thing that just thought of for you guys, which is if you can think like a marketer in terms of your own concept, that's helpful too. Can you pitch your idea in one singular sentence, and how does that translate to a piece of key art? Can you, in your mind, imagine how to sell that concept on a billboard? And if you can, that means that your concept is clear and easy to digest, and those things are also relevant to us as buyers. So if you can be thinking like that, that's helpful too.
I always like pitches that are sort of a combination of the fresh and the familiar, I say. So if you pitch something and I say, okay, well, can you give me some examples of movies that you would compare it to? What are some comps for your idea? And you say, it's like nothing that's ever been seen before. That's kind of disconcerting sometimes, you know, because I think ideas are often recycled. We always take ideas and then, you know, regenerate them. And there's always a spark of something in some movie somewhere that's been done before. And I think the opposite of it's exactly like Safe House. You know, that's not good either. And so I think it's that, you know, really sort of think, again, like a marketing executive, if you had to put together something that marketing executives do a lot is put together a list of movies that are good comps, right? So whether it's the setting or the size of the movie, the genre, the tone, think of those sort of 5, 6, 7 movies, TV shows so that you know them in your head, and then challenge yourself to say, what is unique about my idea? So if you say it's, you know, in the vein of Silence of the Lambs, okay, but what is unique about your story so that I don't think, oh, okay, well, that's a Silence of the Lambs remake. You know, and challenge yourself to have both of those elements there, because I think, you know, we want to know what your idea is like so that we can say, how does this fit into my study? How do I market this? Do I see kind of the movie in my head? But we also want to know that your idea is fresh and has a unique take that is special to your vision.
There's no one lined up at the mic. Did we do that good of a job? Okay, here we go. Great.
Okay, can we turn the mic on?
Turn the mic on, please. Sorry, right there. No.
Hello? Hello? Okay, we've written our script, or we've optioned a script. How important is packaging? Because we constantly hear that the scripts that have no elements go on one file, it's very tall. And the scripts that have elements attached get immediate attention. So as writers and producers, what can we do to make our pitch more attractive to you and to get action?
Well,
yeah.
What I would say, honestly, is when you pitch, I wouldn't focus too much on attachments or this investor in China that wants to give money or this or that. It's all about the story. And I hear this all the time. I mean, again, I've literally heard thousands upon thousands upon thousands of pitches with all executives. Name the company, we've done a pitch session with them, most likely. And it's all about the story, honestly. And if the story speaks to them, your script will go on the top of the pile. I promise you. Attachments, because all these executives, they could get attachments as well, so they'll do the they'll to take care of that easily. But the story is what's going to speak.
Content is king.
Yeah.
Always. Content is king. If you have a great script, it will sell.
Coming up with the point about being a marketing executive, but then in general, how helpful is it for you to have someone bring in visual aids if someone actually creates key art, for example, or if somebody has pictures of references for casting, right? Like, how helpful is that?
I love show and tell. I would say that, you know, the most common mistake in terms of visual aids is don't let them overwhelm your pitch. There's a fine line. I've had producers come in with 17 billboards that they put on poster boards, and we literally need a conference room because they overwhelm the pitch more than the people in the room. Don't have more materials than you can carry from your own car. Please don't hire an assistant to come with you to get those materials to the pitch. It's not necessary. But I love having an actor as a, if you have created a character in your mind and the prototype is, you know, is whoever it is, if it's you know, Robert Downey Jr. is the leading man, then I love having that because it gives me my visual reference too. So the, assigning an actor to it is great. And Joe, and it's a pretty picture.
And I would also just add, play to your strengths. Like, if you don't know how to do key art, then don't make it.
I've seen people turn down products because of key art, and even like a trailer, they're like,
Same here. So if you happen to be a graphics wizard and you can do something that really complements your pitch, great, but don't feel obligated to do that if you have no skills in that arena, because if it is terrible, it's distracting. Obviously take it with a grain of salt and know what you're good at and what your skills are, or if you have a friend who's great at it, maybe that's that.
Yeah, I think I know for the projects that we've picked up before, when we get involved, we help figure out what the marketing campaigns need to be, what we want the visuals to be, and work very closely with the artist to figure out what the vision of the film is, what the world of the film is, and then how we're going to portray that when we advertise it. So I would almost say, yeah, exactly, play to your strengths, and just stay focused on the world that you're creating. Cast lists are fine in terms of helping us understand the type of character that you want to create and how you want to see it portrayed. But when it comes to your marketing artwork, that's, at least for advice, that's where we like to come in, we like to work with you to help you figure out the best kind of artwork that we can make, and we'll put up different kind of artists on spec to help you see that.
My name is Melina Ray Johnson, and I have a question for Jennifer. You mentioned that you changed from being one of the 5 buyers to one of the 50 buyers, and that Netflix, Hulu, and Amazon are your competitors. What benefits does Lifetime have, or another network have, over those new competitors, and what benefits do they have over you?
Great question. One of the most unique elements that we have at Lifetime is that, you know, we do scripted series, we do reality, and we do movies. So one of the benefits of being at Lifetime, which has a movie department, which most other cable networks don't have in this day and age, is that we have the ability to buy something. We can have a pilot, we can have a 2-hour pilot, we can have, you know, we can pick something up for 4 episodes, 6 episodes. We have flexibility that I think that most other networks don't necessarily have. And the idea that we could make a pilot, it could be a 2-hour pilot, and it's still a 2-hour pilot that could still see the light of day. It could be a 2-hour pilot that goes as a movie, even if it doesn't get picked up as a series. And I always say that to people, which is, you have a great concept. We may just test the waters, and it may go on air as a 2-hour movie before as a true proof of concept, and that's a really huge advantage that I don't think many of the other networks have. A lot of us are going straight to series. We're doing that. The other advantage that Lifetime has is that we're a cable network that doesn't buy and develop a ton of things, and when we buy and develop, we really believe in it, and so your chances, your percentages of going to series are higher at Lifetime than they are at other places. The disadvantage, I'm not competing with the financial train that is HBO, and I'm not competing with the financial backing that Netflix has. That's the biggest disadvantage. So my relationships are key. I have to make Lifetime a place where people want to work, because we're gonna spend 17 hours in a room together, and I'm going to give them clear answers at every step of the way. That's one of the benefits that we can do there.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, thank you for coming here today. I've learned a lot. I have 2 questions. One's for Mara, Vice Media. What television show that I'm in right now, scripted television show, that you wish that Vice is producing? And my second question is for everyone here. Wondering, aside from Blacklist's Next Scout, what other websites do you go to scout their scripts?
I'm trying to brainstorm. I'm trying to have a little more time. So Vice, as has been announced a handful of times, we're in the process of figuring out multiple formats that we can work into. This is certainly one of them. In terms of what's on the air right now that I wish we were producing, we're actually hoping to do something a little bit different, which is to really put premium documentary content on TV, and to focus on stories that are raw and that are sort of from the street. In terms of scripted content that I would love to see
It depends, because Vice sort of began as a sex, drugs, and rock and roll magazine. It began as kind of a skater company, and has since progressed as kind of an actual news source. And we're very proud of our HBO show, and we like to move in that direction. So in terms of scripted content, it's hard to say, because we're trying to sort of toe the line, you know, between do you want to have intelligent panel shows, do you want to have something like high maintenance, and sort of reckon back to our old days of what is the brand for us. We're still very much in the process of kind of throwing ideas against the wall and figuring out what we want to be creating. But knowing what I will say in terms of, you know, what we would like to see on the scripted side, knowing the brand, anything that is sort of raw and that has characters that are kind of questionable and that sort of breaks away from mainstream media in the sense that it covers different kinds of topics or it goes into a space that's a little bit more contentious, we love that, even on the scripted side. I would rather see a historical drama about someone who invented a different type of weapon than something like King of Thrones, if that makes sense.
My second question was about
I don't necessarily, those are the two primary, Blacklist is the primary one for me because legally that's all I'm allowed access to, but one of the things that I do outside of that is that I try and connect with various colleges to scout talent, so occasionally I'll offer myself up as a speaker to a class at USC, at my alma mater, University of Arizona. I'll fly back and you know, get in touch with the students there, and I'll offer to read their scripts just because it's an outlet, and I'd like to see what's coming out of the new generation of filmmakers. That's one way I'm doing it.
Thank you.
State32.com as well.
Happy orders. Thank you for your time today. Mara, can you share anything about the recent OTT Women's Channel that Vice is connected?
Yes, happily. I know, that's my feeling too. We're in the process. I can't say too much because it is still sort of growing.
Yeah, whatever you can.
Sure, of course. We're in the process of really kind of collecting women's content and hiring tons of women to create that content.
Also men that support.
Absolutely. Of course. No, truly, it's a joint effort. But what our aim is to do is to tell women's stories that aren't being told elsewhere. There's a certain kind of news that CNN tells, there's a certain kind of news that Fox News tells. And regardless of political slant, women are still not really like properly covered whatsoever. And so what we want to do is we want to talk about contentious issues that most news networks are afraid to shy away from because they are risky. We have really great viewership around the world, and so what we want to do is utilize each of our 36 content producing offices that are globally placed to tell stories in each of those territories that are actually really true to women's experiences the world over. So it's going to be like Vice News, but it's the girl side of Vice News, and it's going to be everything from skate chicks to street artists to chefs to lifestyle to women in war zones.
Great, thank you.
Hi, good morning. My name is Yvette Burks. Thanks so much for your time. You guys have been amazing. So my question actually is for everyone, and it's about multi-platform storytelling. Now the opportunity to expand these great stories that actually do get made. So in terms of buyers, when you're hearing pitches, and has this now become part of just your job description where you actually can start to be thinking about the 360 of a potential product?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, it's in the DNA of any project now. How it lives online, how it has a second life online. If there's additional content, absolutely, it's a part of everything that we think about now. How does it have a second life?
We worked on a documentary called Zero Dreams of Sushi. It premiered in the Berlin Film Festival a couple of years ago, and it did so well, and it was one of the highest grossing documentaries on theatrical that year. It did so well that Netflix did their first docuseries with that director called Chef Story, and it just released in like 2 years ago, but they've been doing really well with it. And so I think, yeah, thinking along the lines when you're putting your packs together, you have to have it as its own,
of course,
but there's all these other opportunities in case there's a success factor.
Got it. So in a pitch, would you advise to wait for an executive to basically kind of bring that up and potentially be inspired before, if you have that in your package?
I would say yes. I would wait for them potentially to be inspired but have it ready to go, because you don't want to potentially kill a deal because you're overwhelmed.
Of course. Excellent. Thanks so much.
Hello. I have two-part question. The first is, you hear these remarkable stories about, wonderful, sounds great, what else have you got? So how prepared do you need to be for that potential question? Does that actually happen? That's my first question.
Yeah, I would say that definitely does happen. So in any pitch meeting, you should always have another log line prepared just in case. And especially if time permits, or with these time regimented pitch sessions anyway, if time permits, definitely feel free to talk about something else. I would say you shouldn't go into a pitch session starting off at this, and this, which I know that was in your question, but don't do that. But definitely go in with just one solid pitch. That's your focus, if time permits, for sure.
I can say I've never been in a pitch where that hasn't been asked. It's asked all the time, and I think you guys would agree. I think the reason why is that they want to know, first of all, you're not a one-trick pony. I think second of all, they want to know that you haven't been so precious about your script. Like, you know, I've a guy that brought me a pitch that he was working on the script for 3 years, and that's, you know, at some point you got to trust it enough to let it go, right? And that just proves that you're not, either you don't have another idea or you're being too precious. So I think that's why, you know, you guys asked that, I would imagine, is to, you know, to make sure that you're not, that's not the only thing you have, and, you know, again, you're not being too precious about the material.
Well, and the same thing would go for general meetings, as was brought up earlier. A lot of times we'll read a script and think the writer is interesting, it's a pass for us, but we'll still sit down with the writer, and you want to know that you have other things in your back pocket. And we've actually optioned things from general meetings where I met with the writer and the first thing I read was a pass, but I said, hey, do you have anything else? And that other thing was the one that we optioned. So you always want to go in with a few things, you know, in your back pocket if you need them, whether you're in a pitch or you've gotten further along, so that people know that you have other ideas cooking.
Okay, a quick sort of technical question for TV series. I focus mainly on features, but I have an idea concept for a series. But I've never done spec scripts on other series to prove that I could be a television writer yet. But my original idea is also a spec, I guess. So I'm not sure how important is it for me if I decided to pitch my TV series idea at some point in the future. Do I need to also still have the backup? Here's my West Wing episode, here's my Justified episode, here's my Game of Thrones episode.
Not for me. I think that was when I first started as an executive years ago. That was part of the norm, which is we want to be able to see that you can mimic another writer's voice. I don't even want to read those, quite frankly, anymore. They're almost irrelevant. I'd rather read an original piece of material, because an original piece of material shows me that you can sell a concept, that you've created a world, that you can create characters, and I get your sense of dialogue. So for me, an original sample is absolutely key over a spec. They're almost irrelevant. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
I have a question about, it's related to somebody's question about your visual representation as part of the pitch. Recently, a friend of mine had a screening event at his house where he was showing these little vignettes, similar to the Whiplash thing, made these little vignettes to represent his feature, and I just thought that was so cool, so I really want to do that. Really, just for no other logical reason other than that, I think it's so cool. So I guess my question is, because it doesn't only show, you know, executives what the film would look like, it also shows me what I can do, because I don't really, like, I'm just guessing, I don't really make the lead in videos. So my question is, if I'm in a pitch, but you guys know what I mean. Okay, my question is, if I'm in a pitch type of situation, and or even if I'm trying to pitch to websites, and I have these little vignettes or a short that represents what the film is going to be like, is it weird to be, like these websites you mentioned, like specs, like, are those just for scripts? Could I put videos up there too? If I'm in a pitch, can I be like, look at my laptop, watch this little thing? Like, sense, Julie, would it make sense to have a short interview situation? Is that?
Well, okay, a couple things. So Spec Scout and Blacklist, those two that we mentioned, are really mostly for scripts, and they post coverage and reviews and things like that. But Vimeo and YouTube and, of course, all these other places are places that you could upload your video, and it could be a teaser or whatever it is. I mean, you obviously want to be conscious of your time in a pitch. So if you were pitching some sort of big sci-fi world, and it would be incredibly helpful to have sort of a visual reference, I think it can be an asset. But I would say, like, work on your pitch in terms of the story, the characters, the concept, and have that kind of ready to go, and be sort of conscious of the length of it, because I don't think you want a 10-minute pitch to be entirely sucked up by showing vignettes. You really want to clarify the world and the story. So, have it as sort of an asset, but not be, kind of goes back to the having a ton of visual aids that you're bringing in from your car, and it becomes the whole thing. So I would say, sorry, I'm coming back from the microphone. Could you hear everything I said? Okay. That's what I would say, personally.
Yeah, for us, sizzles are more and more common, and so typically what happens either at the beginning of the pitch or the end of the pitch, people will use it to represent the tone of their film and the visual style that they intend to create of their film, of their pilot, whatever it may be. So it's really about selling tone more than anything. And in a sizzle, you can cut elements of different pieces of footage from other things, and we'll get the idea. It's mostly tone.
Yeah, that's cool. I know what you said was kind of what I was afraid of. But if I made the vignette other than cutting it into a sizzle, probably festival would make the most sense.
If you make a full narrative short film, I mean, obviously there are a lot of festivals that take short films, and it's a great place to get your work seen. If what you're focusing on is selling your idea that you're pitching, and you just want a little indication of what it looks like, I think a sizzle or a teaser or just something to kind of give a quick look and feel, which, like she said, can be a compilation. A lot of people do mood reels, which might just be a compilation of images from other movies and TV shows to just kind of show the tone of it, or it could be something original that you can go out and shoot and make, which is obviously a little bit more of a time commitment and more sort of financially. So you can go, either way with it. I would say as an asset for pitch, sizzle, teaser, little sort of something is the way to go. If you do want to make a full sort of narrative short film, and there are varying lengths that people make them and put them online or at a festival, that's a way to go as well. Whiplash was a full sort of narrative short that went to a festival. But again, if you make a short film like that and you take it to a festival, it should stand on its own two legs as a complete narrative, not just an indication of, hey, this is what I want to do with the feature. It should be complete in and of itself in terms of the art of it.
I think that's an important distinction to make. If you do like a scene test or something like that, and you want to show us that, and it's sort of more extended than like a mood reel or something that's just a couple of minutes, that's something that if I was showing out your pitch, I'd want to see your scene test ahead of time. The short film, of course, you want to see it stand on its own two legs and kind of have its own life. Whether or not the short film plays at festivals, but it's a factor in this feature or TV series that you want to make, I would want to watch that before you come in. Same with the scene test. If you have anything that's like 2 minutes or under that sort of establishes the tone, I'm at least perfectly happy to watch that interview with the artist to kind of figure out and talk there about how that feeds into the story.
Well, this is awesome information. Thank you.
Hi. This isn't super pitch related, but how do you guys feel about intellectual properties that are developed from books or adapted from books? And like, is that a good thing? And I guess if you're pitching and your property does come from a book, like, how do you
love it?
Right.
To love.
But I think it also depends on typically who published it, right? Like I've had books sent to me that were like published on Amazon. Right? So I think who published it. Like if it's based on a true story, how the rights work out with that, I think is important. So
I developed Vampire Diaries when I was at the CW, and that was based on an Alloy book. And the book was from, it was written in 1999, I believe. So even, when I developed it, it was a fairly aging book, but it didn't matter. The core of the story was there, and it had legs, and so off we went. It's great. It's great to have a source of material to back you up, because again, TV gives you more longevity that you can pull from.
Yeah, I
think especially with Vice, a lot of people come to us with stories from books or from newspapers that they want to turn into narrative content. I mean, I think for us, whenever that's the case, we'd still love it. We absolutely love figuring out different people's stories that we can tell, but it just means for us, we have to figure out sort of what perspective one is against getting the life rights to that story. And we just know that it's sort of it alludes to a different process of development for us. There's just a little more sort of backtracking that we have to do to make sure that we're clear to tell that story in a narrative format. But that doesn't mean that we're any less open to the process. Mm-hmm.
This will be our last question, just FYI. No pressure.
Hey, RV, I wanted to thank you for the Film Curious chats.
Oh.
Those are really, really fun. If other people have not seen them, Steven Spark also hosts, and RV is always there, and they're really, really informative. So thank you for that.
I can't take it's all Steven Spark. Can't take total credit, but I enjoy being on it.
Experiences with different festivals and competitions. So even if you go to Stage 32 and just start a lounge discussion, like, did you ever hear about this one? People will talk about their experiences too. And just to follow up with your question about visual aids, if you go to Stage 32, you are allowed to upload videos as well. I just wanted to mention that.
Yeah, I mean, look at a Stage 32 account as like your personal website. You're in full control of it, full autonomy over it, and you can upload your resumes, upload your videos, and ask people to look at them and network the right way. And it's just great exposure to get your work out there. That's
great. Well, I want to thank all of our panelists. Thank you so much for everything that you've had.